Our riches and our numbers burden the world.
If you remember the dramatic pictures taken by the Apollo flyers of the Earth, standing out in space all by itself, no one after seeing that could deny that the world is finite. Then it's impossible for people to go on saying we have an infinite supply of air, an infinite supply of water, an infinite supply of minerals. Man must learn to balance his activities in nature against the regenerative power of nature, or he is inevitably going to join the Tyrannosaurus in extinction.
As we grow richer, there is rising concern about pollution, our ability to feed a growing population, and fears that we may run out of fuel and metals.
A computer at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology has been used to look at these problems, to analyze in broad terms the direction in which our world is headed. Sponsored by a group of businessmen and academics, the Club of Rome, its conclusions are revolutionary.
The most important lesson is that we're near the end of our development of society, which has been, you know, we've been going on for about 2,000 years. That we've reached levels of prosperity which carry the seeds of disruption and necessitate a complete relook at the whole world's social, political and other situations.
It's telling us that the world is in a completely unstable situation and is likely to fall to pieces if it doesn't stop growing.
Let's put it bluntly. Our option is not between this kind of society, present society, and a stable state society. It is between a stable state society and chaos.
The world is 6 billion years old. That is unimaginable. So think of it as a week. All through Sunday and most of Monday, nothing much happens. Late Monday night, a cell divides. Life has begun. Through Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and most of Saturday, life becomes more complex and more beautiful. In a barren universe, life on Earth is being sustained by an increasingly stable and complex biology. At tea time on Saturday, it is the age of the reptiles. At 3 minutes to midnight, man appears. 1 second before midnight, man the hunter becomes man the farmer. At 1/40th of a second to midnight, the Industrial Revolution begins.
It is now midnight. In that last 1/40th of a second, we have started to get richer at an ever-increasing rate. Growth is explosive. Population now doubles in 30 years. Man now uses twice as much energy as he did 15 years ago. And industrial production has nearly trebled in the last 15 years.
During this program, men on the Earth will consume 200,000 tons of petroleum and 200,000 tons of coal, produce 2,000 motor cars, and use 400 million kilowatts of electricity.
If we use known stocks at present rates, there will be no copper left in 2008, no zinc in 1995, no tin in 1989, and no mercury in 1985. There will be no silver, without which we cannot make films, in 1987.
Today we consume more than yesterday. Our children, if they live as we do, will use up resources more than twice as fast as we do.
Our grandchildren might need twice as much oil as we found in Alaska just to meet their increased needs for 1 year.
Such growth threatens to use up all the resources the Earth has to offer us. Such are the enormous needs of the industrial society in progress.
The Industrial Revolution has consumed vast quantities of fossil fuels, for example, and now there aren't many left. And it's as simple as that. If you have a kind of society which is going to eat the very planet we're on, eat it up, consume it, you will find that there's nothing left.
Our industry, the way we make things, attacks the fabric and stability of nature, the ecosystem, on which all life, including man, depends.
It has been developed to exploit the ecosystem without taking into account its continued existence. And our new technologies tend to disrupt ecological cycles, to break them, to intrude harmful, unnatural materials on them, and therefore to destroy the base of its own existence. Because of that, we are on a suicidal course.
We are faced by dilemmas. Industry cannot exist without the raw materials it must use up. Nor can it function without the natural world that it may be destroying. So great is our progress that it may push the Earth to its limits and beyond. We threaten a confrontation with nature. Progress to that confrontation is speeding up.
What we're really being told is that although nobody knows for sure exactly when it will happen or exactly what risk is the greatest risk man faces, scientists are fairly unanimous in saying that man does face extremely important risks.
When global population is doubling every 33 years, when resource consumption is doubling every 20 years, no long-term view of mankind can proceed without first forming some preliminary answers to these questions.
Professor Dennis Meadows, at a conference in Washington to mark the publication of his team study for the Club of Rome, The Limits to Growth, it concludes that economic growth always generates a crisis, but the road to riches is the road to disaster.
Even if we solve problems like pollution, growth within a century or so would lead to widespread famine and social chaos. Dennis Meadows and his team used a computer. He explains why.
With system dynamics, a methodology that we use, we organize the available information on the relationships in some system, and then we express these mathematically and put them into a computer to calculate the results. It's possible for men to perceive the individual relationships in a system, but very difficult indeed, without any assistance from a computer, to understand what their implications will be when they interact.
At first sight, there doesn't seem to be much relationship between farming and industry, but industry produces pollution, and pollution affects crops. So a change in industry affects farming via pollution. The man-made world consists of a whole complex of subtle relationships like that. Change one thing, and it sets up a slow and complicated chain reaction.
The equations in the computer define these relationships, so the computer can show how one thing affects everything else, not only immediately, but over many years. The runs on the computer show how these things would interact and affect man's future. They used the computer to see what would happen if man successfully tackled his obvious problems, if he grew more food, found more natural resources, and controlled pollution.
But first they ran the computer to see what direction the world would take if it ran its present course.
As the century unfolds, industry grows, as does food production and population. But we're using up all our raw materials, the limited metals and fuel in the earth. These run out. Without fuel and metals for the factories, industry collapses. Farming has become highly mechanized, and without petrol and electricity, food production falls too. There's no food and massive unemployment. So the population falls. People are dying. Dennis Meadows explains.
Because of the high population levels and the increasing industrialization, natural resources are depleted at an increasing rate, and finally they fall down to the point where the industrial system can no longer be sustained.
What might this mean in human terms to the average Western family? Over 50 years or more, we get richer. We consume more and more resources. Things like gas and electricity. When essential raw materials like oil and copper run out, civilized life ends.
If we go on as we are, society collapses because we run out of metals and fuel. Growth is halted by a resource crisis.
Science and technology could help us here. We might find new sources of fuel, use nuclear power, or harness the energy of the sun to replace oil and coal. Metals could be used more carefully. We could save and sort out our scrap. We might find substitutes for scarce metals. So they ran the computer to see what would happen if we solved the resources problem that caused the crisis in the first run.
This time, natural resources used carefully run down slowly. But industry continues to grow. This industrial growth produces a serious pollution problem. Pollution attacks both people and plants. Crops cannot grow, and farming starts to fail. The population starts to collapse when people die of hunger and pollution. Industry, without a workforce, collapses too.
But now pollution is permitted to rise because industrialization goes further, and finally pollution begins to impair the lifetime of the people and the productivity of the agricultural sector.
This time then, growth is not stopped by a resource crisis. Our family grows richer, consuming more and more goods. But the factories producing these goods are also producing pollution. This time it is pollution that halts growth in catastrophe.
To keep growing, we need more raw materials. If we find those materials, growth continues till we die of pollution.
But we could control pollution. Indeed, we are already beginning to do so. We know how to clean up our water and air. The pollution created by technology can be restrained by technology. So in the next run, they assumed not only that we had solved our raw materials difficulties, but that we had controlled pollution as well.
So resources still run down slowly. Industry can expand. Pollution, now controlled, doesn't become a problem. Growth is progressing. But this time, the population grows so large that food becomes a problem. Food production cannot keep pace with population. People starve. And industrial society collapses.
In this case, the land resources become insufficient. Pressure on the land begins to lead to land deterioration. And finally, food per capita collapses and brings about a population decline.
This time, the problem is food. Growth provides us with increasing wealth, but as the population grows, food becomes more and more expensive. The growing food shortage turns slowly to famine.
So if growth is not halted by pollution or a resource shortage, it is halted by a food crisis.
But there could be a solution to that too, the Green Revolution. Scientists have been able to double and even treble yields. We can grow more food. So on the next run, as well as pollution controls and a careful use of resources, they assumed that food production could be doubled.
Resources, still used carefully, fall slowly. Pollution, still controlled, is no problem. And now food production, backed by the Green Revolution, rises. The system is experiencing explosive growth. The lines go off the graph. This growth of industry is so huge and rapid that it suddenly generates a pollution problem, despite pollution controls. And the industry and the population collapses.
Because land is no longer a limit to growth, industrialization rises to the point where, even with the pollution control measures we had before, pollution becomes a very serious problem and again brings about the collapse.
So if we control pollution, conserve natural resources, and grow more food, growth is still halted by a pollution problem.
Technical solutions are not sufficient. Pollution control, resource conservation, and the Green Revolution serve only to postpone or worsen the crises. The obvious is not enough.
The runs illustrate very succinctly that pollution, natural resource depletion, are not problems themselves. The problem is growth in a finite world. So long as we ignore that fact and rely on growth over the short term to solve our problems, overshoot and collapse of the form which we see in the world model seems to us to be absolutely inevitable.
Famine, pollution, and scarcity are not really problems. They are symptoms. Symptoms of growth.
But what about population? Was instability due to the pressures of population growth? A population that doubles every 30 years, that adds 70 million extra human beings to the planet every year? They ran the computer to investigate what would happen if nothing but population were controlled.
Population is stabilized. Only 2 children per family. Industrial production and food production surge ahead, and pollution rises too. The system is growing. But again, industry uses too many resources, which run out, bringing down the system yet again. Even with population controlled, growth brings us up against a resources problem.
So population control is not sufficient either. They made other runs on the computer, different combinations of policies. However they juggled, population controls with pollution controls, with resource conservation, with food production, the result was a breakdown. A breakdown that implies millions of deaths and the collapse of civilized life. What had been the reaction of informed opinion to this study and its bleak prognosis?
Well, I think the study makes an important contribution to the environmental dialogue. It points up some of the fundamental issues that man is going to have to grapple with if he's going to survive and continue to improve his position on this planet.
I think this has two important advantages over other studies in this field, and there have been many other studies. The first is that the computer allows you to handle a very complex situation, an enormous number of interrelated effects. So complex that one could not grasp all these within one human mind. But the computer can handle those easily and explore the way they react upon each other and how they evolve. That's the first point. Second point, I think, is that because you have to put it into a computer, you have to get all your assumptions out on the table. And that means that the thing is very precise, and if someone doesn't like the model or the assumptions, they can see exactly what bits they don't like and take those out and put their own in.
Skeptics say forecasts of doom are the result of doomsday assumptions. Make different assumptions, change the equations a little, you will produce very different results. If you put nonsense into a computer, they say, you get nonsense out.
I think that's a very reasonable response. The question comes, of course, is it possible to put something into the computer which can be defended as reasonable, which alters the conclusions? I'm rather confident that while in the precise nature of our conclusions, there will ultimately be made changes, that the general conclusions, the fact that growth has a tendency to resolve itself through collapse, those conclusions are simply not going to be altered by any reasonably defensible additions to the model.
The computer does not predict. It sketches the direction in which our world is moving. It clarifies some of the conflicts between the natural and the man-made world. Nature is balance. Tamper with one part of it, and the complex and unexpected will turn up in another part. That is what the study shows.
Technological societies, too, are highly interconnected. Intervention in one part, increasing, say, food production, may have unexpected and unfortunate results elsewhere.
It doesn't prophesy, but it does give us a new way of seeing the world. It is showing us how and why some of our most serious problems interrelate.
The model is simple. The world is complex. The crude predictions we see in the study would appear in the world in much more complex ways. The real event, if it happens, would certainly be more complicated. And different kinds of countries are vulnerable in different ways.
It seems obvious to us that decline, if it does come, will be experienced at different times and in different ways in various societies. The United States might conceivably have a natural resource problem, while Japan could conceivably fail to cure its pollution problems and be led into difficulty that way. Some of the less industrialized areas at the same time might be having a food crisis.
The world is running out of many things that it needs. Fossil fuel, for example, is the classic example. But food. We are very, very short of food, and we have two-thirds of the world undernourished to prove it.
A report from the World Bank reads,
"What are we to say of a world in which millions of people are faced with day-to-day deprivations that degrade human dignity to levels which no statistics can adequately describe?"
Many, many millions of people already starve to death in the world. Pollution is killing people. Not very many. The health of a large number of urban dwellers are being is being decreased because of environmental deterioration.
There is authoritative and growing evidence that we are polluting the planet.
Generations will never see the sun. The year 2000 is sufficient to melt the polar ice cap, placing most of the
in an irreversibly polluted situation.
Turned up in the drinking water of the city of Buffalo, New York. It's
nitrate. Appreciable amounts of nitrate.
The mouse trap.
Most of
we don't know how heavily
blue baby disease.
Perhaps millions of people breathe the dust.
Very real danger of large scale contamination.
Is there evidence that the base forces shown in the model are already at work in the world today? Some would say so. And go further. See the symptoms of growth in Vietnam and Bangladesh, in crime rates, and the state of the world's great cities.
You look at the city in America already, the city is falling apart from the center outwards, so that you can't walk in the center of the big American cities without running grave physical risks. They're covered in concrete in cars. Poorer people can't get out of the center and therefore form ghettos. The problems are overwhelmingly bad. I would go so far as to say that the troubles we see are all part of this business of an overloaded society that doesn't know how to conduct itself any longer.
Have to begin to solve the problem of drug abuse in this country right now.
Symptoms of what Meadows is talking about, in my opinion. They're symptoms of instability, and that is what Meadows' model is telling us.
If one looks at the whole world, it is becoming better cultivated and more fully peopled than anciently. All places are now accessible, all open to commerce. And where once were hardly solitary cottages are now large cities. What most frequently meets our view is our teeming population. our numbers are burdensome to the world, whilst nature fails in affording us her usual sustenance. Our wants grow more and more keen, and our complaints more bitter in all mouths. In every deed, pestilence, famine, and wars have to be regarded as a remedy for nations, as a means of pruning the luxuriance of the human race.
Those words were an eyewitness report made during the decline of the Roman Empire.
The Dark Ages followed. If this study is right, then our society is threatened. No one knows when or how. But if it does mirror the world, if we can see in our problems the stresses of growth, then the world is unstable. Growth, it seems, has an awful logic.
It is so obvious, in a way, so simple to consider that we cannot continually and exponentially go, as we are doing now, nothing in the world, nothing in life goes continuously.
Growth leads to crisis.
What then if we stopped getting richer?
Not talking so much about certainties as about risks which no modern society really should be willing to bear. It's almost as though one were playing Russian roulette and there were a 20-chamber gun with five different kinds of bullets. One question could be, what kind of bullet is it that's going to get you? It seems to me a more appropriate question is, do we even want to play Russian roulette?
Is there an alternative to Russian roulette? Is it possible to produce a stable world? Were there policies which would create equilibrium, a balanced world? They found that if you controlled everything, including industrial production, no crisis emerged. But this assumes that we will stop getting richer.
Population was stabilized by effective birth control from 1975. Food production is stabilized using modern techniques at a high level. The key factor, industrial growth, was leveled off in 1975 too, enabling pollution, also carefully controlled, to be kept within bounds. Resources, carefully used, are falling gradually.
When these are implemented in 1970, we see that the world system is capable of moving into a equilibrium society, a stable state system, which can be sustained as long as we analyze it through the computer.
What is being suggested is that the only way to ensure the future for our grandchildren is to stop getting richer. Only then will there be the resources and the unpolluted world that they will need to survive.
The classic assumption that economic growth was what society had to do is being proven wrong. It is obvious that our instabilities are caused by this endless attempt to increase output, call it just output. Now our attempts have got to be directed to looking after people who haven't got anything and to reorganizing our own society so that it doesn't have this built-in instability, which we now have because of the growth phenomenon.
But we expect to get richer. Growth promises a better tomorrow. We all, the trade unionist, the politician, the businessman, all expect growth. But because we expect more, we are careless with what we have. much of it. We junk.
...70% of this tip should not be here. Here are the metals that we grow short of. Here is the oil we transformed into plastic. Here ends the forest we turned into paper.
Resources our children may need, used to wrap up our food, to pretty our shopping.
Nor has wealth solved many of our social problems. Tempted by the trivia of affluence, there's not enough money for housing or the poor.
Often old ecologically sound things like soap, wool and glass have been replaced by detergents, synthetic fibers and plastics. The new ways not only pollute, but use up resources we cannot replace. Detergents, for example, pollute rivers and use up oil.
The benefits of growth are obvious, the costs obscure. At first, growth seems fine. Take the motor car, for example. Motor cars provide an escape route from the concrete cities into the countryside. They have provided millions with the opportunity to travel, to explore, visit their friends, widen their horizons.
Too many cars have destroyed the very freedom that the motor car gave us. Now there's only 65 yards of road for each of Britain's motor cars. London's motorway plan will cost 2,000 million. That money could house 2.5 million people and build 200 new schools. Lead is a scarce metal. 40% of the world's lead production is added to petrol.
A quarter of London is road.
Vehicles produce 60% of our air pollution.
Half of our children will have a car accident.
Each year, accidents cost £320 million and 7,000 lives.
A car driven from Land's End to John O'Groats uses as much oxygen as a man in a lifetime.
To manufacture a car requires 100,000 gallons of water. Each of these cars has used 2,500 pounds of steel, 54 pounds of zinc, 51 pounds of lead, 32 pounds of copper, and some aluminium.
When the study talks of equilibrium, it is talking about halting this kind of growth, the kind that consumes resources and pollutes the environment. But what would equilibrium be like for people?
I think it could be extremely pleasant. We're not suggesting a deterioration of material standards as being necessary to an extent which should in fact frighten many people. Many things can be organized a great deal better materially now. For example, the cluttering of cities with cars, its disadvantages as great as its advantages. But I think that there is a possibility, the world has the possibilities with a little better distribution and organization of providing a decent life with flexibility and freedom for people. But with enormous possibilities of leisure, social development, artistic development, I think it could easily be a much, much richer life than we have today.
There's going to have to be a shift away from an emphasis on material goods to one on the social services. There has to be a shift which views man as part of a total system rather than as man, a person who has been given a system for his exploitation.
But the idea and dynamic of growth are deeply embedded in society. To stop it challenges some of the basic assumptions we make about ourselves and the world we live in.
Business is firmly based on the assumption of growth. To produce profit, to reinvest, and grow is quite literally its business.
Come on, you ain't out, sell 900. Anyone do that?
I'll sell 600.
250 for sale.
The poor of the world look to economic growth for a way out of their poverty and their starvation.
And for us, in the West, it gives us the increasing standard of living we've grown to expect. Our science and technology, too, have been harnessed in the service of growth.
Can such powerful drives, economic and political, social and personal, that support the idea of growth, be redirected? What kind of changes must be made in our economic system, in our politics, in our minds? How do we organize the world without growth?
What must we change? Growth since the war has been created by improved technologies. They have provided us with cheaper goods and industrialists with larger profits. But the impact of science was one-sided. Most ecologists, including those with reservations about the study, agree on this.
Most of the ecological difficulties that we face in the United States, and I'm sure it's true in Britain too, have developed as a result of technological transformation since World War II. This is the period in which the environmental crisis has become so intense. Now, during that period, the U.S., and I think also Britain, engaged in a very intense research program in biology and medicine, unprecedented size and intensity. And so here we were with an unprecedented research effort in biology, and all the while the biological system on which we depend was being degraded without our being aware of it.
Scientists were taking apart the world and looking at the parts. Industry, technology, took that knowledge and exploited it. But nobody was looking at what was happening to the whole system, at what the effect of these changes would eventually be. It was, quite simply, nobody's job.
The main thing, I think, is that it's the dismemberment of science into isolated specialties and their failure to develop, a complex pattern which matches the complexity of nature, which has kept science rather isolated from a problem like the environmental crisis, where nature exists as a whole.
Do we need a science that looks less at the way things are and more at the way that they relate and change?
Can we create a technology consistent with nature?
When we talk about shifting to equilibrium, we're not talking about shifting to a state which will lock in the poorer areas to a permanently inferior status. I personally don't believe there's any possibility of having a viable long-term solution which leaves such glaring disequalities.
Well, we must expect the third world to fight for their share of the cake. It is completely absurd to think that they are going to stop growing when they haven't got a thing. So I believe that unless the rich part of the world makes a careful plan and begins to spend real money in adjusting the balance between the two, there will be absolute uproar, and I mean physical violence. It's inevitable unless these plans are made.
Our development has proved unstable. What form will their development now take?
And if equilibrium means equality between nations, does it mean more equality within nations?
Well, this is going to be a very difficult one, because businesses have always gone ahead on the assumption that they're going to be bigger and more profitable than last year. And I don't think that this can possibly go on. And businesses have got to stabilize themselves along with everything else in society.
My feeling is that since environmental analysis, along with many other things, reveals, to me anyway, that the private enterprise system is simply incapable of staying off a suicidal course, that the system will simply have to be changed.
Bill Marsh! Yeah. Quoting sides on full main, common, and preferred.
Can business as we know it survive the transition?
On what? Common? Preferred?
If so, how will it be changed?
If not, what will replace it?
At 9, last 7-8.
Burgess, 3858. How about Wells Fargo?
So what do we do about population? How will we control our desires to have children?
How do we change the idea that population control is for other people, usually the poor?
Today the economy has to grow by about 2% just to keep people in work. Without growth, there will be less work of the kind we do today. Work, for good or bad, is what most people now do most of the time. In the stable state, work will become much less important.
A lot of things like this have got to change. I think that it's high time we gave up the Puritan notion that work is the only good, and found ways of organizing society so that people could do more or less what they wanted. After all, automation will take care of work if you plan it that way.
There might be more subtle changes. With less work, with fewer children, with different patterns of consumption, family life might change. To conserve resources, things like motor cars and washing machines might be shared by larger groups of people.
I'd like to see people experimenting with, communes, things of this kind. Because unless we make those experiments, we are not going to be able to adjust to this different kind of world.
It's important, I think, to realize when we talk about this stable state that describes a large number of possible alternatives. We're not talking about some uniform society which would blanket the globe. Certainly not talking about that type of uniformity. We're talking about a system in which the various balances between material output and population can be engineered more or less to suit the particular objectives of a society.
Equilibrium will be a very different world. It could also be a very varied world, a world with all kinds of societies. But they will all be societies radically different from ours. If it is right, then this study forewarns us of a watershed in human history.
It's wholly revolutionary in its very nature. Hitherto, we've had revolutions thrust upon us by people who couldn't stand it any longer, and then there is bloodshed and all sorts of horrors. Now, we now know, I contend, that we have to have a revolution, and we ought to be able to plan it.
Let's not overlook the fact that human society has gone through a number of revolutions in their implications, even perhaps more profound than the one we're talking about today. Just at the dawn of man's history, we saw a transformation from hunting and gathering and nomadism to settled agriculture. The impact of that on man's religion, on his institutions, on his view of himself, were enormously profound. The shift from rural to industrialized man has been an enormous change. The shift from a primarily agricultural to a primarily urban population has an enormous impact.
Our own society reflects its origins, the Industrial Revolution. That revolution molded our institutions, changed our politics, and shaped our lives. The Stability Revolution, the Equilibrium Revolution, whatever future historians choose to call it, will also shape and change the way we live.
The study has a sting in its tail. We're short of time. We have to act soon to keep our options open. This study and others show that there's a point beyond which it is difficult to pull back from disaster.
Now, I'm a layman, but I've received a lot of scientific evidence, and my impression of that evidence is clearly that the decisions which man takes in the next decade or two, this coming generation, are really going to determine his future. So many of these things are going to be difficult, if not impossible, to reverse if we are not prepared to face them and to reorient our activities and our attitudes on a global scale. I think that is possible, but it's probably the biggest single task that mankind has ever faced.
We can maintain for ourselves today a very much higher material standard of living, but at a cost, very likely, of decreasing the options which exist for people 50 or 100 years from now, our children, our grandchildren. So this dilemma between satisfying needs in the short term and satisfying them over the long term is perhaps the most fundamental one that comes out.
If that is the case, then what can we do now?
It's important that everyone should have a concept of the world as a whole and should avoid as far as possible bringing up their children in any sense of local patriotism, nationalism, and parochialism.
It's important for you, I think, to realize that you have really the right only to have two children, to expect that you're going to have to make short-term sacrifices if they're to have a decent environment and the resources necessary to pursue the kind of life that they should have.
First of all, inform yourself. First of all, become interested. Then let your political leaders, both locally and nationally, know that you're interested and show them that you're informed. Then look at your own habits as consumers, as producers, and the things that you do in your daily life, and ask yourself what effect they're having on the whole problem. Are they making a positive contribution, or are you part of the problem?
Is it necessary to buy the kinds of products that you do, and isn't it possible perhaps to use them somewhat longer and slow down the flow of material goods through your household?
This transition from the present type of society for the new society, which will be balanced with its environment and within, depends on all of us, on all of you, and that will require political action.
Men, for the first time in the history of man, have the opportunity to design the society they want and the resources to put that into effect. Now, that is the guts of the matter to me. We have to think out just what society do we want. We can have it, you know.
We have to imagine what world we would like.
Perhaps, it seems, our children could live our dreams.
Imagine no possessions.